Hello everyone. Today we are going to see design of springs. Let us see first some of the basic things which are related to springs. What is a spring? What is the working of a spring? What is called as a spring? As you can see here, the spring is the one, it is the machine part which is going to deform when you are applying a load. And once you remove the load, it regains the original shape. Such part is called as a spring in general. Now there are different functions the spring is going to carry out, like to absorb energy by getting compressed. The example is shock absorbers. All of you know in the vehicle there are shock absorbers. So they are storing the energy, they are absorbing the energy by way of compression. To apply force, as in the case of brakes and clutches. Now here the springs are used for applying force. As another example, it can also be used for measuring the force as a measuring device. As in case of a spring balance, you can measure the force by using a spring. Other alternative or other way of using the spring is for storing energy, as in case of old watches, as one of the examples where we used to store the energy in the spring and that energy gets released as the watch starts functioning. Different types of springs are there. Helical springs like a coil, in that there are subtypes. Compression spring, which looks something like this. Tension spring, that means its initial length is less. When you apply force, its length gets increased. Then torsion spring. Now this spring is something which is applied by a torque and then it functions. Then a conical spring, which in fact is a case of a compression spring, only it has got a conical shape so that it will remain stable under the action of end load. These are all helical springs. Then there is something called a lip spring. Now these are the springs mainly used for, say, trucks, one of the examples, or heavy vehicles. This is made up of a plate. Several plates are clamped together and then the plates are of a spring material, so they work like a spring. Meaning that they deform when you apply load and they come to the original shape when the load is removed. In case of vehicles, it could be used as a shock absorber. Then there are disc springs or belly well springs. Now this spring, if you see here, the basic spring is like a dish. This is a basic shape of the dish. This is a cross section. And then many such discs, when they are put one on top of another, there is a hole here. So through this hole, you can put some device as a guide. And then this spring, because it has got a spring action, that means initially it is like this. And when you press it, then its shape changes to this. So it gets deformed, again it comes to the original shape, and as a result it functions together as a disc spring, as one of the types. In brief, let us see what is the material that is used for the spring. It is a oil tempered carbon steel, and the percentage of carbon is in this range, 0.6 to 0.7% carbon, and about 6 to 1% manganese. That is the composition of the spring steel that is used there for the springs. Now having understood some brief things, now let us go further ahead and see some terminology that is used for springs. We are considering helical spring. With circular cross section. So although there are so many different types of springs, we are going to concentrate on one particular type of spring. There is a helical spring, which is a compression spring, and the cross section of the wire that is used is going to be a circular cross section. Let me draw a spring as an example. this is a spring. This is the cross section. Since it is a cross section, let us draw like this. So this is the wire diameter D. Then this is the coil diameter, capital D. Then this becomes the outside diameter and this becomes the inside diameter. Inside diameter of the coil, outside diameter of the coil, the nominal diameter of the coil, that is D, taken from the middle of the wire. And then this is the axis. So these are some of the turns. Then there is something called as N, that is number of active turns. And there is N dash, which is equal to N plus 2, that is total turns. As you can see here, these are the number of turns, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and so on. These are the number of turns. They are of two types. One is the active number of turns, that means those are those turns which are taking part. They are the active turns, and as you can see here, the last turns which are there, this and this, they are not going to take part in deflection. Therefore, they are added in the total number of turns. So the total number of turns is equal to the active number of turns plus 2, that is the total number of turns. So now let us see, after understanding the nomenclature that is used for this particular spring, let us see what are the different formulas that are related. So as I can see here, D is wire diameter, D is coil diameter, DI is inside diameter, DO is outside, in an index already written here. Then there is something called as spring index, that is shown by letter C, that is D upon D. This is called as spring index, ratio of the coil diameter to the wire diameter, that is the spring index. Then there is something called as spring stiffness. Now this is load upon deformation. So suppose W is a load. So load upon deformation, that is the stiffness. This is Newton per length unit, maybe millimeters. Delta is deformation. That means under the action of load W, it will get deformed to some extent. So that deformation corresponds to the load. So the ratio of load upon deformation, that is called as stiffness. Spring stiffness, there are different names. It is also called as spring constant. Spring stiffness or spring constant. So these are some of the turns. Then we also see what is called as a pitch. Pitch means the distance between two similar points. So that pitch distance is written as free length upon N dash minus 1, where LF is free length. Free length is, as you can see here right now, this is the free length. LF is free length. Now what is the free length? I'll just write here. Free length consists of what? It consists of delta max plus solid length, that is N dash into D, plus the formula says it is N dash minus 1 into the space that is there. Say, where 2 is the distance between the coil. Now, sir, see what this says. free length is made up of, now this length is made up of what? Suppose you make this fully solid, then that is the length, that is this length. That means the number of coils into the diameter, that is going to be the solid length. Now, in addition to solid length, now this solid length right now also exists here. It is distributed here, solid length. Then whatever is the deformation, delta max suppose is the deformation, then the solid length plus this deformation, these are the two terms there. And after the deformation has taken place, whatever is the space between the two coils that is remaining. Now this space, which is shown as n dash minus 1 times whatever is the space between the two. Now here I am assuming maybe say 2 mm space, and it can be anything else. So any such space, this is just an example. So the space between the two coils into this many number of coils, that means n dash minus 1, these are the spaces. So these many spaces into 2 mm as an assumed gap, that becomes a total free length of the spring. So this is a formula for the free length, and these are some of the other terms which are used for the purpose of design. Now having done this, let us see how we go further for the design. Stresses in springs. Now as usual, when we start designing any component, what we first see is what are the different stresses that are acting on the part, and then accordingly we write the different types of design equations, and then we come across, or when we solve those equations, we are in the position to find out the various dimensions of the parts which are involved there. So similarly, there is a spring as a part which is undergoing some kind of a deformation because of this load W, and as a result it is inducing, some stresses are induced in the spring. So now let us see what are the stresses and how do we work on them. First thing is, as you can see here, because of the load that is acting on the spring like this, this is a cross section of the wire. So that wire is under the action of a shear stress because the surface is parallel to the load. So as usual, the first stress is the direct shear stress. So I'll call this as FS1. So direct shear stress is FS1. Now this direct shear stress is given by load upon area. So load is W, and area is pi by 4 b square. Now is there any other type of stress also acting there? Now as you can see here, the load is acting here at the center of this coil, and it is at a certain distance from the wire. So this distance is d by 2. So I'll just show here, if this is the cross section, I'm drawing this particular cross section here, and then this is the coil, this is the center of the coil, and the load is acting here as W, and this distance is d by 2. Now what this means is, this force into this distance, that is W into d by 2, that is going to be the torque, T, equal to W into T by 2. This torque is acting on this particular cross section. Now when this torque is acting on this cross section, we have got a formula, we have got a design equation which can relate this torque with the torsional stress that is induced in this particular cross section. So that becomes the second type of stress. So right here, torsional stress, right here as FS2, and that is given by FS2 is equal to T into 16, or I'll write the earlier formula first, T equal to pi d cube by 16 into FS2. Therefore, FS2 is T into 16 upon pi d cube. So one stress is the direct shear stress, the second stress is the torsional shear stress, and since both the stresses are of same type, it is possible for us to add these two stresses. So I'll write here total stress. Total stress, which is the shear stress, is equal to Fs1 plus Fs2. Fs1 is this, and Fs2 is this. So when you add these two stresses, that becomes the total stress that is acting on this particular cross section. So then I'll just write here. So these particular two stresses which were written earlier, if you rearrange them, the equation comes like this. These are total stress. Now when this is again solved and rearranged, this gives us 8WD upon pi d cube into bracket 1 plus 1 upon 2C. Where, as you know, C is a ratio or spring index, ratio of capital D upon small d. So when you rearrange, this is the result, and after this it is written as K into 8WD upon pi d cube. This K is shown as K is actually, and this K is shear stress factor, which is nothing but 1 plus 1 upon 2C. So shear stress that is there, that is acting in this cross section, this shear stress is equal to already Fs. The total shear stress acting on the cross section is given by shear stress factor Ks, which is this, into 8WD upon pi d cube. W is the load that is applied, d is the coil diameter, and small d is the wire diameter. So this gives us the stress. So if you are going to design the cross section, that means the wire diameter, then this particular formula will be helpful for finding out what is going to be the wire diameter for a particular type of material which has got certain stress, and then when a load of W is applied while the coil diameter is D, you can find out the wire diameter. This is one of the design equations that is what is required by us, and this is the one that is derived here. Now having done this, there is one more option there. Earlier we have seen that there are two types of stresses that were developed in this cross section. But in reality, there is one more type of stress also exists. That is at the moment not considered, but that also exists. That is called as a stress because of the curvature effect. So I'll just explain what is called as curvature effect. As you can see here, the wire which is initially a straight wire, that wire is converted in the form of a coil, and after that some heat treatment etc. is carried out so that it gets the property of a spring during the manufacturing. Now when that happens, when a straight wire is converted into a coil, at that time the wire needs to be curved. So as a result of that, because of the curvature that is induced in the wire, certain stresses are built into this particular wire everywhere, all over, because the straight wire is converted into a coil. So that is called as a stress because of the curvature that is given to the wire So that is called as a stress because of curvature. And what we do is, certain experiments were conducted earlier, and as a result, there is one factor that is called as a wall stress factor that is taken into consideration. So stresses due to effect of curvature. So if you want to take this into account, then what happens is there is a factor called as wall stress factor, which is shown as K is equal to 4C minus 1 upon 4C minus 4 plus 0.615 upon C. So you can find this is a factor that is called as a wall stress factor. So this wall stress factor, which is made up of this equation, which consists of capital C, which is nothing but a ratio of these two diameters. So this ratio, that is C, is used in this equation, and that gives us wall stress factor K. And this wall stress factor is used in the design equation. So the earlier design equation, what was obtained, I am writing again. So F shear is equal to, earlier we had written equation which was having Ks and then it was having 8WD upon pi d cube as the equation earlier. Now what is done is this shear stress factor which was there earlier, which was 1 plus 1 upon 2C. This was the shear stress factor by not considering the curvature effect. But if you want to consider the curvature effect, then all what is done is this Ks is replaced by K, where K is this. So we are replaced Ks which was there earlier by K, and K is given by this. After you do this, then the same equation is possible for us to use as a design equation. Now this is taken into account everything, the earlier two stresses, that means the direct shear stress and the torsional shear stress, and the third stress because of the curvature effect. All the three stresses are combined together, they are taken into consideration once you apply wall stress factor in the equation. So this is the equation with considering the curvature effect, and the earlier equation where K was replaced by Ks, that time that was the equation, earlier equation, that was the equation that was without considering the curvature effect. So they are the two equations depending on what the problem states or depending on what is the condition. Sometimes the statement of the problem says the design a spring without considering the curvature effect. Then you can use Ks in this equation. Sometimes the problem says that design the spring considering the curvature effect. Then we have to use K, which is the wall stress factor given by this. Okay. So that was the way the design is carried out, in which case we finally find out what is going to be the wire diameter by using this particular equation. Now see, the design work is not over just by finding out the diameters. There is one more factor there, that is how many number of turns you require, like what we have written here earlier, N. N is the number of active turns, N dash, that is N plus 2, that is the total number of turns that we need to know, what are going to be the total number of turns. So how do we find out the total number of turns? For that is one more equation or one more formula that is there, which will be useful for finding out the number of turns, but that needs to be derived. So let us go to the derivation of a formula which is used for designing the number of turns. Deflection of spring of Now, how to relate the deflection of spring? with the other parameters. That is what we are now going to see. Now, let L is equal to total length. So the total length of the wire, right from here till here, this total length is small l. Now this small l is going to be equal to pi into d, that means the circumference, into the number of turns that are there, which is n. So l is equal to pi d into n. Now the next thing is, let us now see here, the coil, I'll draw the coil again here. Like this is the coil, here is the sender, and the load is acting here. Now what happens is, as a result of this load, the coil is, just imagine that it is deformed by a certain amount, and as a result, this line has come somewhere here. That means certain deformation, this much amount of deformation has taken place. Deformation. Now this deformation, and this length, and this angle, what is going to be the relation of all that? So as you know, in general, suppose this is the distance S, and this is the distance L, and this angle is theta, then we say that S equal to L into theta, when theta is in radians. This is a general formula everywhere we apply. So the straight distance, or the curvature it is, but even if the distance is small, it is considered a straight line. So this distance is given by length into angle in radians. Now this particular principle is used here when we say that thus the coil is going to deform, and this deformation in our case is going to be delta. So when the coil is deformed by delta because of the load W, then this deformation delta is something similar to this. And then what is the cause of this deformation? This length has rotated by a certain angle. So what happens here is, we write deformation, the actual deformation of this spring delta is given by angle into, now this distance in our case is d by 2. Now where is this angle? This angle is not literally this angle. This angle is the overall angle by which this entire length, starting from here till here, you can imagine something like a three-dimensional angle, just for that. So this angle is the angle by which the entire coil is deformed, and the deformation you have to relate like this. That vertical distance is the radius, in this case the d by 2 distance, and the d by 2 distance is deformed by a certain angle. So theta is the angle by which the spring is compressed. Now in reality what happens is, as a result of all this, is that this particular wire, you can think of something like this. Suppose I draw like this. This is the axis. This is a fixed point. Then suppose you apply a torque at this end. Then as a result of this torque, the rod is going to twist by a certain angle theta. And the rod has got certain length L. Now whatever is the way these parameters are related, that is exactly what is happening here. So certain torque is applied, because of that certain torque, this is a wire, in our case this is the wire. There is a torque, here also there is a torque because of this W. And as a result, the whole wire is twisted, and the amount of twist in the overall wire of a full length L is this twist. So this condition is similar to what we are doing here. So that is written like this. The formula in this case is T upon J is equal to G theta upon L. So this is a normal design equation which is used for the purpose of designing the rod for the rigidity consideration. See, this is the rigidity consideration here, where the stress is not there, but the material property is inside G. That is the modulus of rigidity, material property. So material property equal to externally applied parameter like torque, and other things are dimensions. So any design equation, as we have seen earlier, consists of externally applied parameters.